Hello, everybody, and welcome to another exciting hour of Mid-South Wrestling. I'm Jim Ross, and along with Joel Watts, we'll be describing the action. Ladies and gentlemen, matchmaker Grizzly Smith has assembled one of the most fantastic cards in Mid-South history. You're going to see some tremendous single competition with such international stars as Mr. Unpredictable Dick Slater. You'll see the Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer here in action, and a great one-on-one matchup between the undefeated on television, El Casario, the martial arts expert, going against the man with the DDT, Jake the Snake Roberts. And Joel, we have got four of the greatest tag teams in wrestling right here today, and one extremely unusual match.
You're absolutely right, Jim. Some great tag team action for you today. The Mid-South Tag Team Champions will be in action, Al Perez and Wendell Cooley. You'll also see the former Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death, in their first appearance back here on Mid-South Wrestling in quite some time in tag team action. Also, as Jim was saying, for the first time ever on Mid-South television, we're going to see a main event between the Fantastics, Tommy Rogers and Bobby Fulton, against superstar Bill Dundee and Dirty Dutch Mantell with a whip on a 10-foot steel pole next to the ring. It should be a fantastic match. I can't wait to see it.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that match, the first time ever on television, so we've got a tremendous hour for you. Thank you so very much for being with us. Let's kick the hour off with a great video that we're receiving a lot of response on. The subject, Al Perez, Santana and Winning. It's produced by Joel Watts. Let's see it now.
It's Winning by Santana, and Al Perez and Wendell Cooley are certainly doing that. The Mid-South Tag Team Champions, they've held on to them. A lot of people said that they couldn't, but they certainly have them. Enough said. Next week, I'll have a video on Wendell Cooley. It should be a good one from the raw footage that I've got so far. It looks like it'll really be a fantastic video. Coming up next, we've got Al Perez and Wendell Cooley in action. Let's go to the ring.
This event, a tag team bout, one fall with 10-minute time limit. In the red corner, the team of Carl Stiles and the Red Raider. And across the ring, their opponents, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Al Perez and Wildcat Wendell Cooley. Your referee, Tommy Gilbert.
The East-West Connection, Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Wildcat Wendell Cooley from San Antonio, Texas. From Tampa, Florida, Al Perez, ladies and gentlemen, as we wait The official signal, there's the bell, and we've got tag team action, and we've got some of the greatest tag teams in wrestling right here today on Mid-South. Once again, thank you very much for being with us.
Cooley with a tag into his partner, Perez. Perez goes to that arm bar. Both Cooley and Perez become very intent when they decide to go after a certain part of the body. Perez, Joel, quick tag in.
One thing I've noticed too, Joel, is their teamwork is getting better and better every week. Right there's a great example. Scoop slam by Wendell Cooley. He and Perez both are extremely strong, but they've got the big country boy from the hills of Tennessee, 290-pound Carl Stiles.
Wendell Cooley going after that arm. Like I said, these two men both very tenacious. Carl Stiles there with a couple of illegal blows to the forehead of Wendell Cooley. Perez in. He hits Carl Stiles with a hard forearm. Stiles down to the canvas. Oh, Perez, all 290 pounds, belly to back suplex. Beautiful maneuver.
Belly to back suplex, the winners in quick fashion, explosive teamwork. Al Perez and Wendell Wildcat Cooley, and we'll be back with Jake the Snake versus El Casario after this timeout.
This bout, one fall, our 10-minute time limit. In the red corner from Puerto Rico, El Casario. And from Atlanta, Georgia, in the blue corner, Jake the Snake. Harl Fergie, your referee.
Jake the Snake Roberts, the man with a DDT, and you can hear the fans yelling DDT, DDT, as we came on here, ladies and gentlemen. Carl Fergie calls for the bell. It'll be El Casario. And Joel, one point I want to add right here. Well, matter of fact, 2 points. One is El Casario undefeated on television thus far. And secondly, General Skandar Akbar is missing. He isn't at ringside. We heard that explanation from Cowboy Bill Watts last week in regards to Akbar's disappearance. Thanks to the Midnight Rider and Hacksaw Duggan and Hacksaw Reed, Akbar has gone to the sanctuary of who knows where.
Well, it's certainly good news in my opinion. I can't say that I particularly cared for Skandar Akbar. The action in the ring speaks for itself. A Mid-South Wrestling main event. El Casario versus Jake the Snake Roberts. Casario poised and ready for that karate chop. Referee Carl Fergie was there.
Well, the fans are saying no, and what they're saying no about is the referee asked Jake if he pulled the mask to take down El Casario. El Casario, short chop. Remember, those are deadly weapons, those hands. We have Jake Roberts, and that's all America. There's nothing martial about that. Martial law, maybe, but not martial arts.
I've sometimes wondered about El Casario, and he's somewhat mysterious. That mask lends a lot to him. He goes for the DDT.
Well, everybody has seen the film. That's one thing about this tremendous television exposure, the number one wrestling program in the country. And Jake the Snake Roberts says, hey, I want to get it on. Let's go.
Whoa, Casario. As I was saying, you got to wonder about him sometimes. He seems to have an extremely devious mind. But Jake the Snake can fight fire with fire in that department, because he is most certainly one of the quickest thinkers in the wrestling business. El Casario quickly gaining momentum on Jake the Snake. He knows that he has got to put the pressure on this man if he wants to gain a victory. And it is an important, important match for both of these men. He goes to a claw hold right around the heart area. There are a lot of nerves and very important blood vessels in that area. Casario is attacking them at this point. He's also keeping his weight above Jake the Snake's shoulders. Now there, I think he made a tactical error by standing up and letting Jake the Snake get to his base, because that's where Jake the Snake can really hurt you. He gets his leverage, gets his distance, and he can explode and he can uncork on you.
Well, apparently El Casario, Joel, I obviously didn't hear you, but he has got right back to a very sound tactical maneuver. A while ago, I wanted to add that he was really kicking Jake in the ribs as hard as he can kick. Those savant-like kicks, you talk about busting some ribs in a hurry.
Well, no doubt about it, Jim. If he gets the distance and can unload on Jake the Snake with that savant-like kick, I don't know if even Jake the Snake will be able to get up from that, because, brother, there are not many things as devastating as when he gets that 200 plus pounds behind that kick, all that momentum. or he goes to chop to the chest.
Very contrast in styles here, and El Caserio's style somewhat hard to figure out for many opponents. And he has got that claw, and he's got it buried.
There we see him again, once again, keeping the weight over the shoulders, trying to keep Jake the Snake down on the mat.
Don't forget now, ladies and gentlemen, stay with us. Coming up, the first time ever on television, a whip on the pole tag team matchup. We'll tell you more about it a little bit later in the hour. But whatever you do, don't go away.
Jake the Snake fighting up to a base somewhat, but El Caserio there raking the eyes of Jake the Snake. Oh, Jake with a kick to the midsection. A hard right. He lashes out against Caserio, but Casario's got him in the turnbuckles. He has got him in the ropes, and that is a tough place to fight back. Carl Fergie keeping Caserio off. And now Caserio goes back once again to that claw hold, this time up in the collarbone area. An extremely painful area to place that kind of a claw hold. Again, it keeps attacking those nerve centers. That's one of the things about the martial arts is you learn nerve centers and pressure points, and you learn how to attack them quickly and add as much punishment as possible.
Jake Roberts agonizing there, and boy, I tell you, El Caserio has been vicious on that arm. Jake's going for the mask. Hey, he doesn't mind Joel taking a shortcut. He wants to win. That's what he wants to do. That's what he's in there for.
Hey, brother, anything it takes, Jake the Snake is going to do it. He says money changes everything, and there is certainly a lot riding on this match.
Certainly great to see him with Hacksaw Duggan last week. Boy, what a team they're going to make. When they really get it all going, man, they are going to be an awesome team. It's my opinion, they're a great team right now.
No doubt about it, Jim. Both of them, double tough, great tacticians. Listen to this crowd getting behind Jake the Snake Roberts. I never thought I'd hear it a few months back, but the people have just really grown to love this man. He's such a competitor. He's got such a great fighting heart. There he comes off the ropes. A knee lift! A knee lift, and he is turning the tide on El Caserio. Look at that, his arm. Numb. With the punishment that Caserio reaped on him.
Certainly has limited use of that one arm. Jake, you heard the people. They're yelling.
Well, he went for the clothesline, but he missed it. Caserio with a kick to the midsection. Still, Jake the Snake arm looks as if it's numb. Caserio attacking his pressure. Oh, he goes to kick Jake the Snake, but Jake blocks it with his arm again. He blocked it with his arm again, and you gotta wonder if he has much use of it. There he went for that kick. Clothesline!
Jake Roberts has very limited use, and listen to the people! They're standing! They want it! They want the DDT!
And they're gonna get it! The DDT!
Jake delivers the DDT! Nobody gets up from that. 1, 2, and 3! And the referee can count to 30! Jake the Snake Roberts, and we'll be back with more after this from the exciting Mid-South Wrestling Network.
Thank you for staying with us, ladies and gentlemen. And, you know, last week on Mid-South Wrestling, Ted DiBiase, Dr. Death, and Bruiser Bob Sweetan came to the ring with Jim Ross and conducted an interview wherein Ted DiBiase mentioned that he had to cut his trip to Japan short because of what happened in the Mid-South. Dr. Death and Bruiser Bob Sweetan losing the Mid-South Tag Team titles to Al Perez and Wendell Cooley. Ted DiBiase said that he had granted Bruiser Bob Sweetan power of attorney to represent him in tag team matches. What DiBiase basically got at is that he feels that he has lost a lot of leverage, i.e. he needs a title to get towards Ric Flair, he needs a title to get to Duggan to accomplish all of his goals here in the Mid-South. What proceeded was a very startling incident. Let's watch that back now.
I gave you power of attorney to do just that, to represent me, so Mid-South couldn't interfere. And very simply putting it, Sweetan, you blew it. You blew it, Sweetan. You blew it, and nobody does that to me. Nobody.
Just a minute. I didn't blow it. I'm not the one that lost the fall. It was your partner that lost the fall right here on television, so don't be blaming me for the titles not being where they're supposed to be.
Look, Sweetan, he may have lost.
Yeah.
push her up. Now we've taken care of that business. I want you to go get Grizzly Smith. Get Grizzly Smith over to the ring and go up that dressing room and bring them two paper champions that say they're the Mid-South Tag Team Champions down here right now. Because Dr. Death and his partner, Ted DiBiase, are going to show all these people right here today, if we can get it done, who the real Mid-South Tag Team Champions go take care of him. Come on.
I mean, go take care of him.
Come on, Grizzly Smith. Come on down here. I want you to go out there and get those two paperweights, those two champions who are nobodies, and get them down here in the ring. Get them down here in the ring. That's right. Because there ain't nobody.
Boy, this is broken out to a pair six brawl. Looks like Sweet Tan was fired, so to speak. But he isn't taking it too well. He's badly lacerated. But Sweet Tan, a former brass buck champion, and King Rat, toe-to-toe. Dr. Death coming from behind with a steel chair. He's thrown in the ring to DiBiase. Sweet Tan's intercepted that chair. He's ripped DiBiase's coat. He's ripped his shirt. Bob Sweet Tan, I'll show you why he's a brass buck champion. And DiBiase and Dr. Death. Dr. Death just got crowding him. It's out of control here. Bruiser Bob Sweet Tan is really hot. DiBiase ripped from limb.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, Ted DiBiase's so-called firing of Bruiser Bob Sweet Tan certainly backfired on the Big Cheese. I know we haven't heard the last of that incident, and we're going to see one of the most awesome tag teams in wrestling. Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death in action. Let's go to the ring now, and Boyd Pierce.
Tag team action, one fall, or a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase. And his partner from Oklahoma University, Dr. Death, Steve Williams. And across the ring from the state of Kentucky, Tony Falk. And Chattanooga, Tennessee, Pat Rose.
Tag team action, ladies and gentlemen, here on Mid-South Wrestling. Thank you very much for staying with us. Jim Ross and Joel Watts at ringside as we get ready to kick this one off here, ladies and gentlemen. The referee calls for the bell, and in my opinion, Joel, and it's just strictly my opinion, but I feel like that Ted DiBiase, Dr. S.D. Williams are as good as any tag team in wrestling. They have it all, and I think that Mr. Rose and Mr. Falk are in for a true test in this encounter.
Well, Rose and Falk are certainly in for a true test, as you said, Jim Ross, and I think Al Perez and Wendell Cooley are going to be in for a true test as well. Whoa! Dr. Death! With a hard right uppercut to the chin of Pat Rose. He fires Rose off, elevates him. And now Dr. Death quickly and confidently tagging into his partner. They wrestle together as well, as you said, Jim, as anybody in wrestling. They're a hard elbow. You notice they haven't even let Tony Falk get into the ring yet. Rather, they haven't put Pat Rose in a position to tag. They're Rose in a position to make the tag, but he was just too obliterated to even do it. DiBiase just pulled Falk in. High vertical back suplex.
DiBiase has every single offensive maneuver in wrestling. He has the master, no doubt about it. I did think we saw a tag there, Joel, and these men are devastating. And that clothesline, he was number 76 from the Oklahoma Sooners.
Thank you for correcting me on that, Jim.
Whoa, what a headbutt.
There. Dr. Death could be so vicious. He fires Falk to the turnbuckle, and Jim, they are manhandling these two men. I don't think we've seen one aggressive maneuver that has had any success from Falk and Rose thus far.
Well, they're certainly gearing up. They want another shot at those Mid-South Tag Team title belts. They'll do anything to get the opportunity, and they'll do anything to win the belts. And look at this, Joel.
We've never seen this tactic before from these two men. They've obviously been working on something new. Whoa! The Oklahoma Stampede off of the second rope. What could be more devastating?
A tremendous victory for DiBiase and Dr. Death. And we'll have a special presentation from Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert when we return after this timeout.
Ladies and gentlemen, Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert has requested and has been granted time by the Mid-South Wrestling to present an announcement at this time.
Thank you, Boyd Pierce. You know, I have a great, great legion of fans, I think. And they've really overwhelmed me here lately with their support. You know, it's hard being a celebrity like I am. It's hard being great looking like I am. Without these young girls and ladies really pestering you and bothering you. See, it's hard for me to even go to hotels. I've been asked at some hotels not even to stay there because girls keep calling, girls keep coming. They jar up the telephone lines and the hotels ask me to leave just because Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert is the best looking professional wrestler in wrestling today. And I realize that. And see, and I understand too that after a lot of my matches, a lot of my fans, and I'm sure there's a lot of them, they want a piece of Hot Stuff. They want something of mine. They want a touch. They want my autograph. They just want something. So boy, with the brain that I have, I came up with a solution to that. I came up with a great solution to that. What we have here, ladies and gentlemen, is Eddie Hot Stuff Gilbert's solution to all you girls out there that's ever wanted a piece of Hot Stuff. Please control yourself, please, please, please. I'm about to unveil something here that will shock the wrestling world and will probably make all you people sitting at home start sweating and go in shock and want to grab a hold of your TV set and pull it up next to you and put those rosy red lips of yours up to this. So what I'm going to do is, oh, this is hard. I'm telling you, please control yourselves when this happens. When I take this black covering off, I want everyone to control themselves, please. Because I realize that what you're about to see is gonna make you just tremble and smile. So here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, let me show you what I've done for some lucky person. Now, I went to a lot of time, Boyd Pierce and you people, and a lot, and I mean, I stress this greatly, a lot of expense to have this beautiful, beautiful portrait. There's not another one like it in the world fixed and made. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to make a little offer to all you wrestling fans watching, a little contest here. You've always been asking about how can you have a piece of Hot Stuff. Well, all you have to do, ladies and gentlemen, is write in 25 words or less why you would like to have this portrait. My gift, I'm giving this out of the heart of myself. My gift, 25 words or less, just send it in care of Mid-South Sports and Eddie Gilbert, and this will be theirs, Boyd Pierce. And I know it's a lot to be given, but I think somebody deserves it.
There you are, ladies. Whatever turns you on, different strokes for different folks. Let's go back now to Jim and Joel at the desk for the details.
Well, he's a humble little fella, I guess, huh? Well, in any event, girls, if you would like to win that beautiful portrait, it is a beautiful portrait, as a matter of fact. The address is on the screen. You can write Hot Stuff, care of Mid-South Sports, 116 West Breckenridge in Bixby, Oklahoma, 74008. 25 words or less why you like to have that beautiful portrait in your home, your room, or wherever, maybe your garage. But in any event, ladies and gentlemen, that is the way that situation is. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert has made his statement, and we'll be back with the Mad Dog right after this from the exciting Mid-South Wrestling Network. Thanks for staying with us, everybody. Jim Ross and Joel Watts back at ringside. And ladies and gentlemen, about 2 years ago, Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer was preparing to do battle with the Junkyard Dog. And we received a piece of footage from Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer that showed his preparation to go against JYD. Mad Dog says he's the number one dog in wrestling. I don't know too many people that would dispute him in that fact. Let's go now back in time and see that piece.
Look into the eyes of the Mad Dog. The training of the Mad Dog. For the one and only Junkyard Dog. Junkyard Dog, look at the Mad Dog. No, he's not pretty. But Junkyard Dog, he backs up from no man. No man on God's green earth. Least of all, another dog. Look at the Mad Dog. Back with his own kind, he feels so at home, Junkyard Dog. He dreams of you at night, and he howls and he screams. He says, there's only one dog, and it's me. No, Junkyard Dog. Look at him, he's been training for hours. Look into the eyes of the Mad Dog. Look into his eyes, Junkyard Dog. And see what real fear is. There can only be one dog, and it's the Mad Dog.
Look into the eyes of the Mad Dog. I think that says it all. Let's go to the ring and Boyd Pierce.
This event, one fall or a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 255 pounds from St. Petersburg, Florida, Buzz Sawyer, the Mad Dog. And across the ring from New York, Broadway Joe.
Broadway Joe, the bell is sounded. Broadway Joe Malcolm is in there with the Mad Dog, and he is as physical and as brutal as anybody in professional wrestling, and he is taking it to Broadway Joe. He may wish he was back in the Big Apple after Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer takes a bite, and he is taking a bite, literally out of the Broadway man.
Man is as physical as anybody you'll ever see in professional wrestling. Broadway Joe just barely getting that coat off, and he looks dazed and confused. Sire, he has him up. He's got him on the turnbuckles. What's he doing? Oh!
He planted him. That is the most devastating power slam I've ever seen in wrestling right there. The Mad Dog, Buzz Sawyer, didn't he get his bandana off? Look at the face. Look into the eyes of the Mad Dog right there, and we'll be back with Mr. Unpredictable, Dick Slater, right after this.
Thank you for staying with us, everybody. And as a lot of you already know, Mr. Unpredictable, Dick Slater, has invaded the Mid-South area. He's got a jet-set lifestyle, and he is definitely a vicious competitor. Let's watch a short video clip on him to I'm Bad, I'm Nationwide by ZZ Top.
Out the wheel. We're going downtown in the middle of the night. We're laughing and I'm joking and we're feeling alright. Oh, I'm bad. I'm nationwide. Yes, I'm bad. I'm nationwide.
He travels in the fast lane, as evidenced by that 911 Porsche with his mystery lady at his side. Mr. Unpredictable Dick Slater, ready to do battle here on Mid-South Wrestling. Let's go now to ring announcer Boyd Pierce.
This bout, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. In the red corner at 235 pounds from Tampa, Florida, the Unpredictable Dick Slater. And across the ring in the blue corner, his opponent, Rick Dunn. Tommy Gilbert, your referee.
Here we go, ladies and gentlemen. We'll get our second look at Mr. Unpredictable Dick Slater. Tommy Gilbert calls for the bell. This man with a renowned reputation, Joel. You went to Atlanta to sign this man. He says he's here on a mission, not titles. He wants money, and he's got something else in his mind. I guess only time will tell in that situation, but in any event, he is a renowned star in wrestling around this world, and he is here in the Mid-South, and he is really, really making some waves.
Well, it's just further evidence of the fact that if you want to really make a name for yourself in professional wrestling, the Mid-South area is the place to come. the toughest competition anywhere in the world, in many wrestling experts' opinion. Dick Slater there shows that he can hook it up to the best of them.
He's got quick hands, and that right hand put Rick Dunn right to the mat.
Whoa, there's that devastating elbow.
Talk about a high impact specialist.
No doubt about it, he executes such great technique. And that double arm suplex, this could be it.
Mr. Unpredictable Dick Slater completely dominating Rick Dunn, ladies and gentlemen. And we'll be back with a match everybody's waiting for. It's the pole tag team matchup, first time on television. And we'll have it for you right after this from the exciting Mid-South Network.
This event, one fall, our television time remaining. A pole match, the stipulation. You'll see the whip of Dutch Mantell atop the steel pole attached to the ring pole. The team that is able to get that whip down will be able to use it in this match. Your contestants in the red corner, Dirty Dutch Mantell and superstar Bill Dundee. And across the ring, from the City of Angels, Bobby Fulton, Tommy Rogers, the Fantastic.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've been waiting all hour for this one, to the first time ever on television. A whip on the pole tag team battle. Where else but Mid-South Wrestling. Jim Ross, Joe Watts at ringside. Thank you so very much for staying with us and joining us here, ladies and gentlemen. You're the most important part of Mid-South Wrestling. The fans watching this program. Joel, this is quite a matchup. There's a lot of bad blood in this situation.
I don't know about it. This situation goes back quite a ways. There's been a lot of heat between these four men. Tommy Rogers going after Bill Dundee, who's going up to that pole. There, a nice shot by Paul White. You can get an idea of how high up that pole is, and Dundee is going right after it. Of course, this is the main weapon in this match. Whoever gets that whip has got a definite advantage. As Dutch Mantell says, whoa! Dundee with a headbutt. He's about to knock Tommy Rogers off that top rope. You got to realize there's concrete down there. This is extremely dangerous.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, you talk about tag team strategy, you talk about a lot of things, but you can throw any kind of common strategy and normal game plans out the window as far as this match is concerned. And Dundee goes off backwards, and Tommy Rogers is trying to go right up that pole and get the whip. Mantell trying to come down. He's bringing him down. And I tell you, I'm getting so excited, Joe. It's hard to call the action in this thing.
Well, if this would have been a single match, I think Tommy Rogers would have been able to make it up to the top. A definite example of the strategy that you were talking about. Or the strategy going out the window, rather. There goes Dundee into the boot of Bobby Fulton. Oh, Fulton with that hard right cross. Dundee goes tumbling down. He makes the tag to Dutch Mantell. Bobby Fulton again immediately going after that whip. You hear the fans getting behind Bobby Fulton. These two men, such tremendous athletes. They're so quick. There goes Tommy Rogers. Like a cat. Up that pole. But Dutch Mantell's got him by the ankles. Mantell has got him by the ankles.
He's got both feet. Boy, that's a dangerous situation for Tommy Rogers.
Oh.
I tell you, it's a dangerous situation all the way around. And it's hard to call the action. It's so unorthodox, ladies and gentlemen.
Tommy Rogers hung in the ropes. He's in a very precarious position.
Look at Mantell climbing right over him and his legs tangled. He's climbing right over like he was a stair or something. And Fulton coming back, and there goes the Dirty Dutchman. Rogers desperately needs to make the tag. But Dundee, now look at Dundee going up the pole.
Well, the focus has certainly been on that bullwhip thus far in the match. And Jim, again, I reiterate how extremely dangerous it is up there. Dundee with a fall from way up. Bobby Fulton go up, he's scaling the pole, he's about to get it. You gotta realize too, Jim, when these men get to going, this kind of physical activity, you tend to build up quite a sweat.
and that can hamper your progress up that pole.
Look at Mantell climbing right over Fulton. He wants that whip. He wants his shoe, baby, and he wants it bad because nobody, and nobody in their right mind wants to feel the sting of that bull whip.
Well, Mantell has said on many occasions that that whip can stop a one-ton bull. There's no doubt it can stop a 225-pound wrestler. Fulton with left crosses to the chin of Dundee. Dundee staggered. Fulton getting a taste of revenge on Dundee. Dundee and Mantell have pulled out all the stops. Anytime they've been in any kind of confrontation with the Fantastics, no tactic is beneath them. Dundee goes again to the pole, but Bobby Fulton stops him. Dundee with a hard turnbuckle. He's scrambling for that pole. Up he goes.
Look at Dundee.
Fulton's after him.
Dundee is just like a, I don't know what, he just run at the pole. He's agile. That's one thing I'll say. All four of these men are agile, for that matter.
But Dundee has exceptional balance. Oh! Dundee there with a bad fall.
Dundee tied in that top rope. We got now all four of them, I'll tell you. This match has been from one side to the other side, up and down the pole. It's quite a rivalry you've got right here on these four athletes. Mantell coming. Mantell stopping Fulton from going up the pole. I feel sorry for Carl Fergie, Joel. He's having a heck of a time controlling things as Rogers goes out.
He most certainly is, Jim. This match has been mayhem from the bell. It has been a Pier 6 brawl with an interesting twist. That bullwhip on the pole. Momentum slowing down a little bit now.
I don't know what Dundee and Mantell are both doing in the ring. Fergie's got to get one of them out of there.
He most certainly does, but Tommy Rogers decides to even up the score as he comes in and wants all four men in the ring. It's a Donnybrook.
All four of them in there, they're going fist and fire, ladies and gentlemen. Remember, the ultimate prize is to get up the pole and get the bullwhip. I don't know if that's on their mind right now. Yes, it is. There goes superstar Bill Dundee trying to get up the pole.
He's going up, Jim, but he...
Look at Fulton checking the ropes. Dundee can't get his balance. As Rogers and Dundee are still hammering each other, Dundee slammed off the top rope.
Just Mantell goes up. Mantell quickly going up, but Tommy Rogers is after him. Rogers is after him. He's got him stopped. Whoa, there goes Dutch Mantell off the top rope. These men are going to be hurting in the morning, Jim. There's no doubt about it.
Maybe a call to the chiropractor in the morning.
Wait a minute.
There's Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. What the heck is he doing?
All four men are occupied, and Gilbert goes up to the rope. He's going up the pole. He's got the whip. He has got the whip, and somebody is in deep trouble.
Fergie's calling for the disqualification. I thought so. There's no reason for Eddie Gilbert to be in the ring whatsoever, but Gilbert got the pole, and he's lashing. He's lashing Bobby Fulton. Rogers is outside, and now it's 3-on-1. It is 3-on-1.
Dutch Mantell got Tommy Rogers on the ring post, but Tommy's in. He's got a hold of the whip. He hammered Gilbert. He nails Dundee with the butt of the whip. He's got Dutch Mantell down, and he's choking him with that whip.
Dundee went all the way over the top and all the way out of the concrete, and they're nailing Dutch Mantell. Here comes Hot Stuff back in the ring. Gilbert throwing powder in the face of Tommy Rogers.
Gilbert.
Mantell and Gilbert, they're double-teaming Rogers. Are folded, and Rogers is blinded. He's on the outside, and they're whipping him.
Mantell is laying it in. He has taken the hide of a Bobby Fulton, and down goes Carl Fergie. Mantell just hammered Fergie. Oh, got it. Tommy Rogers in with a chair. He has got a chair, and he's standing him off. He evens the score.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've got a disqualification in this situation. The winners of the match by disqualification, the Fantastics. Bill Dundee got the worst of that situation, no doubt about it. And you saw Eddie Gilbert and Dutch Mantell. They double-teamed the Fantastics. We have not heard the last of this situation. And ladies and gentlemen, next week here on Mid-South Wrestling. If Wendell Cooley and Al Perez are still the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, and by that I mean they've got some title defenses signed, if they're still the Tag Team Champions when we come back here for television, ladies and gentlemen, of course that goes for any title match that we announce, they're trying to get it signed, Joe. Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death against Cooley and Perez for the tag titles next week.
What a great main event that's going to be. I can't wait to see that myself. Title match or no title match, those men are going to have a barn burner of a match. I could guarantee you that. A lot of other great things happening too, Jim. It's going to be a great hour next week. We hope you can join us.
Ladies and gentlemen, it has been a tremendous hour. Thank you so very much for taking the time to join us here on Mid-South Wrestling. You are the most important thing we have. That's the great wrestling fans of the Mid-South. For Boyd Pierce, my colleague Joel Watts, I'm Jim Ross saying until we see you next week, ladies and gentlemen, on a great hour, we'll see you next week for more Mid-South Wrestling.
Hello, everybody. I'm Boyd Pierce, your host on Mid-South Wrestling Television. I'm glad you joined us. A lot of exciting action coming up. We'll see Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer in action here this week. Also, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions, Wendell Cooley and Al Perez, will be in action. The unpredictable Mr. Dick Slater is on the card. And Nick Patrick takes on the rugged Ted DiBiase. But tag team action, it'll be Dirty Dutch Mantel and El Casario against Jake the Snake and Hacksaw Jim Duggan. To tell you all about it, along with Jim Duggan, who's here with us now, the president of Mid-South Sports, Cowboy Bill Watts.
Well, we're going to be talking to Jim Duggan shortly, but Boyd, first of all, we have an announcement. The Barbarian has mysteriously disappeared. Now, Humperdinck later is going to, I'm sure, accuse Jake the Snake Roberts of some illegal tactics, and maybe Hacksaw Duggan's involved, and he's, I think, claiming a parking lot situation, and certainly you've had some bad experience in those. And I know that, I won't say anything. I'm not going to draw any conclusions. But right now, the North American title situation is hotter than ever because of remarks made by Ric Flair. There's more top contenders than ever. Hacksaw Butch Reed, standing to my left here, Jim Duggan. Ted DiBiase's back, Jake the Snake Roberts. Unpredictable Dick Slater here on some kind of a mission. Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer, Al Perez, a lot of really tough competitors. This situation's really heated up, and Ric Flair made some comments to Jim Ross in Alexandria the other day. Let's listen to these comments.
Ladies and gentlemen, as all you fans in the Mid-South know, the world heavyweight champion Ric Flair has created quite a controversial situation, as he usually does inside the squared circle. But this time, the words of Ric Flair has created perhaps the most controversial situation surrounding the North American title in the history of Mid-South.
Jim, it's very simply this. I've made it very clear to the officials of Mid-South and to the National Wrestling Alliance that I will not defend the World Heavyweight Wrestling Championship against anyone in this area other than the North American Heavyweight Champion. Now, if that's Murdoch, that's fine. If that's Reed, that's fine. If that's Jim Duggan, that's fine. It seems like the three of them are in the middle of a big controversy themselves. That's not my personal problem. I'm Ric Flair. I'm the man that, whether you want to believe it or not, dictates the wrestling scene around the world. And I'm making it clear to you, Mr. Ross, I'm making it clear to the officials of Mid-South, and I've made it very clear to the president of the NWA that when I come into this part of the country, I'm only going to defend the title against the North American heavyweight champion, regardless of who it is. You're not going to force me into matches with Murdoch, Reed, or Duggan unless one of them is wearing the North American title, and that's the bottom line.
I want to say one thing that's crystal clear. As president of Mid-South and matchmaker Grizzly Smith will bear this out, and so will Jim Crockett of the NWA, that Ric Flair doesn't get to pick his matches. I don't care what he says. But he's really added some intensity to the North American title. And I'll tell you one thing, there's a couple of guys, and one is standing real close to me, that he doesn't want to wrestle again because you had about the toughest match that I've ever seen in Alexandria.
Well, I tell you, it was really a surprise for me because, you know, a lot of times old Hacksaw loses his composure and gets disqualified real quick. But I kept my composure, I kept on battling, and Ric Flair, the great competitor he is, he had more than his hands full, I'm glad to say.
Well, let's show the fans the closing moments. Now, we're about 25 minutes into a grueling match for the world's title. All the prestige and money riding. And Ric Flair has found that Duggan has pushed him to the wall. He can't handle it. He's looking for a way out. Let's look at the closing moments of that match.
A grueling match, Jim Duggan. And there you see Ric Flair going for his pet hole, the figure four leg lock, which no one can break. But fortunately, because of your football and your background and God's gift to you of size, your legs are big, and he has not got your leg, that's the figure four part, up high enough where it's into your knee that causes that excruciating pain. You've got it slipped down there to the shin area, and he can't really complete the figure four leg lock. It looks like you're trying to get out of it desperately.
Well, that's right, Cowboy. That was one of them Fancy Dan moves that old Hacksaw's not too used to. But I just know if I kept plugging and kept working and try to tuck my hips, that I could flip him over and reverse that Fancy Dan hold.
That's right, and now the pain goes to him because his legs are in that perfect figure four position. You've got him in a lot of pain there, but he's slapped. He slapped Tommy Gilbert. What you couldn't see on camera there was Ric Flair reached out and slapped the referee, Tommy Gilbert, to get Tommy Gilbert to disqualify him, intentionally getting him disqualified to save his title.
Well, it caught me off guard a little bit there for a second. I thought I've actually won the world's title there, and now the referee is going to go disqualify. But, of course, a little persuasion. But I want a real good shot at that title, and I don't want no disqualification. I want a piece of Ric Flair. And, of course, there you see the referee says, go ahead and wrestle.
And Ric Flair is really unhappy. He thought he'd saved his title. He's a desperate man. He doesn't want to face you there. He knows the tremendous backing you have all throughout the Mid-South and the tremendous determination you have.
So there you go. A little bit over-anxious shows maybe a little bit of inexperience in a type of World Championship type match, but that's just the way I am. I got to go for it 110% with a gusto, and he just kind of caught me with that quick knee.
Now he's going out, and he has decided to go ahead and try to injure you by running your head in that steel post, which also is a disqualification. There he goes intentionally.
Well, now he's in my territory. He wants to get down and start fighting on the floor. He's talking Hacksaw Jim Duggan type of match. Of course, so there again, I lost my head and went ahead and rammed his head into the turnbuckle, not realizing it was disqualification. And then here the referee is, and of course now the realization of a DQ is coming through. But again, the referee decided it's one up, one DQ for each of us.
I guess he decided tit for tat there, but Ric Flair badly lacerated. He's really upset that the referee is not calling this match a disqualification and saving his title. He's desperate. The champion's been pushed to the wall. There you go, trying to vertical suplex from the outside in. We hear Tommy Gilbert telling you to break the hold, that he's not in the ring, that you can't bring him in that way.
Well, that's suplex is not really in my arsenal of weapons, but when you're in a World Championship match, you kind of pull out all the stops, do whatever it is necessary, and here I'm trying some things that I usually don't try.
Well, Tommy Gilbert making no count or anything. I think he wants to give Ric Flair time to recover since you've pulled him into the ring from the outside, which is an illegal maneuver. He won't count the fall there. He's telling you to let him up. Of course, in the heat of the battle, you know you got the advantage. You got to fight him the way he's been doing you.
A little loss of composure there. I just go back to brass tacks, good old 1-2 American know-how. Now I'm going to set for that spear, that fine NFL training showing. I set down there. You can see a good three-point stance, good acceleration out of the blocks, and
right there, I want to call for the slow motion of that because this was a critical point. You saw Tommy Gilbert. As you're coming for that spear, we see Ric Flair pull Tommy Gilbert into the way. He threw the referee's body in between him and yourself, dove out of the way, and you annihilated the referee here. And I think that was a straw that broke the camel's back. But it all shows the desperation of Ric Flair trying so hard to hang on the title. He's forgotten about trying to beat you, Jim. He's just trying to hang on.
Well, of course, fatigue has started to take its toll now in a long, grueling match like it is. And I do agree with you there that he did pull Gilbert deliberately in front of me, trying to cause a disqualification.
And Gilbert's calling for the bell. He's had it. He just says this is out of control. He's calling for the bell. Jim Duggan, the winner. You hear the crowd behind you. You are the winner. But Gilbert is disqualifying the world's champion, Ric Flair. He's finally managed to save his title. He lost the war, he lost the battle, but he got out of there with the gold.
Of course, in all the heat of the battle, I lost the idea that I don't get the belt out of disqualification. Here I am celebrating with the fans because that's what it's all about. It's a fan's belt, and I just love to bring it home.
As I say, Ric Flair barely escaped the title, certainly not his pride. You took him to the wall, and three times there was a situation that called for disqualification. I think Tommy Gilbert, the referee, really stayed with it a long time, too.
Well, he certainly did, and I'm glad to say that he went that far with it, because I thought Ric Flair, hey, why don't you shut your mouth? I think Ric Flair, hard for me to concentrate, Mr. Watts, with the way this trash
out here. You remember the rules, that if you're here at the desk, you can't jump in the ring, it's a $2,500 fine. I see Buzz Sawyer out there challenging. He's trying to take a cheap shot, but let's just cool
it
right.
Well, if he wants a shot of Hacksaw Duggan, he'll find I'm not a hard man to get a hold of.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we'll try to get this under order, and we'll be back after this break, boy.
This match on Mid-South Wrestling, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first in the red corner at 255 pounds from St. Petersburg, Florida, Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. His opponent weighs 225 pounds from Chicago, Mike Nichols.
The confrontation taking part, the bell has yet to ring. Mike Nichols as he takes on the chain-wielding Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. You see the referee Carl Fergie trying to get him apart. Before the match starts, he's explaining the rules, but you see the unruly Mad Dog. Bill, this looks like this is the first match. If it is, we're in for a wild and woolly night.
Well, that's right. He's challenged Hacksaw Duggan even during the commercial break, and Duggan has had to be restrained. Buzz Sawyer, the man that calls himself the master of the dog collar match, and he asked Mike Nichols to put it on and go dog collar style, but Mike was, I'm sure, making it crystal clear he hadn't signed that kind of match. That kind of match is for a different breed of cat, a guy that's, you know, got one oar that's maybe not too stable in the water, because it's a brutal match. But I'll say one thing, Buzz Sawyer keeps challenging Hacksaw Duggan, and you don't have to send him an engraved invitation to come to any kind of fight. Buzz Sawyer, a tough athlete, an explosive individual, a man that's, he lives with the dogs. He's got Rottweilers, pit bulldogs, everything. He is, like I say, he sometimes is more animal than man. Powerful, explosive, 250 pounds, an international star. The North American title situation is heating up. Everything is heating up here. Seems like it. Oh, did you see that move? Did you see that power slam? He climbed up the, he just came off. I think he just planted Mike Nichols like no man has ever been planted. One,
and
two,
a
three.
Brutal tactic gains a victory for the Mad Dog, and we'll return after this word.
Mad Dog, he's got that chain out. Hold everything, Boyd. He's wrapping that chain around Mike Nichols' neck. Carl Fergie trying to restrain him. It's an automatic disqualification if you attack your man after the fall.
He had the chain that was over in the corner and used it. Now we'll be back right after this word from the exciting Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
Well, Boyd, we almost had an unscheduled bout going on during the commercial break. Hacksaw Duggan was challenged by Buzz Sawyer, who really has a screw loose, and Sawyer was challenging him to a dog collar match. And you know, you don't have to send Duggan any invites. He came out and took the glasses and his shirt off, but was climbing in the ring. But Sawyer tried to attack him with that logging chain. Well, anyway, it's back under control, and we promised you a special video on Wendell Cooley, and Joel has it. Titled, the song is If Heaven Ain't a Lot Like Dixie by Hank Williams Jr. Let's watch this video, and then right from that into the ring is Al Perez and Wendell Cooley will be wrestling.
If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I don't want to go. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I just as soon stay home. I was one of the chosen few to be born in Alabama. I'm just like my daddy's son. I'm proud of who I am. I went through a lot of good women, shook old Jim Beam's hand. If I never see the pearly gates, I will walk through the promised land. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, and stay home. If they don't have a grand old Opry like they do in Tennessee, just send me to hell or New York City. It would be about the same to me. I got wild honey trees and crazy little weeds growing around my shack. These dusty roads ain't streets of gold, but I'm a happy right where I'm at. Little southern bells are a country boy's dream. They ain't got wings or halos, but they sure look good to me. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I don't want to go. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I'd just as soon stay home. If
they don't have a grand old Opry like they do down in Tennessee. Just send me to hell or New York City, it would be about the same to me. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I don't want to go. If heaven ain't a lot like Dixie, I just as soon stay home.
This tag team event on Mid-South Wrestling One Fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first the team in the red corner. At 225 pounds from Romania, Gypsy Joe. His partner weighs 233 pounds from Miami Beach, Florida, Brody Chase. Their opponents, the Mid-South Tag Team Champions. Introducing first at 238 pounds from Tampa, Florida, Al Perez. His partner at 236 pounds from San Antonio, Texas, Wendell Wildcat Cooley.
Brody Chase and his partner, the experienced Gypsy Joe, take on the popular tag team champions of Mid-South, Al Perez and Wendell Cooley. Now you see Tommy Gilbert calling for the bell. One man is Gypsy Joe against Wendell Cooley. Here's Bill.
Well, Wendell Cooley, a youngster that finally got a chance to start him and really has come through. He came here, he had a lot of fire, a lot of desire. He was booked in a lot of matches against main eventers. He gave a good accounting of himself. He learned the hard way. And I think, without a doubt, I've got to agree with most fans. When they faced Sweet Tan and Dr. Death, they were thinking about Snake and the Barbarian. And these kids slipped up on them, but it was a grueling battle. And since they've got those titles, it's like they say, enough said, we got them. Somebody's going to take them off of us. And they have really given a great accounting of themselves. I want to thank Joel again for that video of Wildcat Wendell Cooley. Fine young man. Perez, a good amateur background. He's got one of the most beautiful belly-to-back souples I've ever seen. High arch. Oh, he just slingshotted Brody Chase and changed his dentures. There you see that tremendous suplex. One, two, three, and the champion again.
And that's one of the reasons, maneuvers like that, that they are the Mid-South Tag Team title holders. Wendell Cooley and Al Perez will be back after this message from Mid-South.
Dick Slater, without a doubt, is one of the most unpredictable athletes in professional wrestling. He's a true mercenary, a man that accomplishes his goals at all costs. But I've known Dick Slater since 1973 in Florida. But he's done something that everybody's trying to figure out. He has a valet, or I don't know really what you call the lady that's with him in her capacity. He calls her Dark Journey, and I don't know what the relationship is. But she did a video for Dick Slater. And Joel, they recorded and filmed it. The music's Dress You Up by Madonna. I think after you see this video, it's going to make you have an opinion about their relationship.
Style, that's what all the girls say.
This match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first in the red corner, at 234 pounds from Tampa, Florida, the unpredictable Dick Slater. His opponent, 235 pounds from Louisville, Kentucky, Steve Constance.
Now you heard the introduction. You've heard it earlier from Cowboy Bill Watts and now from ring announcer Jim Ross, and I'll make it a perfect threesome as Dick Slater is certainly unpredictable, and now he's going in against Steve Constance.
Well, boy, first time we saw Steve Constance on wrestling, he had a partner named Tim Ashley. And Tim Ashley was injured in that match. He got a brain concussion. And, you know, in athletics, you got to expect some hard knocks, but Tim Ashley decided professional wrestling wasn't for him. But it's a credit to Tim Constance. He came on his own, and now he's against one of the toughest international stars in wrestling, a man who says he has a mission, but he's been hired by somebody. He has not revealed to us what the mission is or who's hired him or what his purpose is. But Dick Slater doesn't do anything without a purpose. And, of course, as you saw that video, again, that relationship is it's a mysterious thing. He calls her Dark Journey. She seems to be his companion. I don't know if you'd call her a valet or if it means more than that, just what it is. But right now, Steve Constance is finding out. He's getting a real gut check. He's finding out what it's like to be out there with a man the caliber of Dick Slater, a man that's 250 pounds, 240 pounds, who's quick, agile, vicious. I can assure you, Dick Slater is a double tough hombre. Inside cradle, he's got it. Steve Constance comes out. You know, the one thing about being in the position of Steve Constance is you got everything to win and nothing to lose when you're a young rookie going up against a guy like this. And this man's aware of it. It sometimes, if you can not think of Dick Slater and who he is, it could release the pressure on you, because if you could beat him, the whole wrestling world's gonna know about it. Dick Slater again, he is just vicious, as you see in the background there walking along the ringside. Dark Journey. We have Sir Oliver Humperdinck coming up next with Humongous and the Nightmare. In a tag match, then Nick Patrick against Ted DiBiase. Then our television main event, Hacksaw Duggan and Jake the Snake against Dirty Dutch Mantel and El Casario. Next week, right here on TV, Butch Reed will defend the television title. The Fantastics will be here, Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert, Al Perez, and Wendell Cooley next week. We're trying to sign a title match with them against Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death Steve Williams, so Grizzly Smith is still negotiating that. The Sleeper and Dick Murdoch. Carl Berg is calling for the bell. Dick Murdoch has put Steve Constance. He has shut down the carotid arteries, and Steve Constance is in what you call a state of sleep. It's a form of the blood being shut off to the brain. That Dick is walking away. It doesn't look like he's going to wake the kid up. Fergie's raised his hand, and Slater's ignoring it. Generally, they're real quick to get out there and get the kid breathing and started again, because you don't want him to stay unconscious too long.
He needs to wake him up right now, Bill.
That's right, because you can have a result of brain damage if you're not careful. That's a dangerous hold. Sometimes people take it a little too lightly, but it's a dangerous hold, as one television host of a talk show found out when a wrestler put it on him and dropped him on the floor, and he got 21 stitches in his head. This is a dangerous hole.
We'll be back now with tag team action after this important message from Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.
This tag team match on Mid-South Wrestling, one fall, the 10-minute time limit. Introducing first the team in the blue corner, at 231 pounds from Atlanta, Don Turner. His partner at 236 pounds from Paducah, Kentucky, Tony Falk.
I'll add the introductions if you don't mind. Ladies and gentlemen, the combination of the Nightmare and from the Valley of Death, Humongous. But I want to take this opportunity right now, as long as I have the microphone, I have your attention to tell you a few things. First of all, the Barbarian was attacked by everybody's favorite, Jake the Snake Roberts, outside a gymnasium. It didn't happen in the arena, it didn't happen in the ring, it happened on the street. Well, Jake Roberts, if that's the way you want it, that's the way you got it, brother, because I can play the same game as you.
Now, criminal charges are pending against Jake Roberts. I don't know if I'm going to take him to court or not, but I'm going to get even with you. And as you can see, I've got the Nightmare with me. The Nightmare is dedicated for one thing. You embarrassed him, Jake Roberts, right here on this television program by pulling that mask off. So he's got your number, Jake Roberts, and he's going to get you any way he can. And as far as Humongous goes, he's been playing around so far, Daddy. I'm pulling out all the stops, and I'm going to show everybody a new dimension of Humongous.
Well, Bill, we heard the explanation, and we also heard the warning from Sir Oliver Humperdinck.
Well, I don't know how you could make Humongous any more vicious than he is, and certainly the Nightmare was embarrassed by Jake the Snake Roberts. And he has seemed to have an added intensity to all of his matches since then, as he starts out with Don Turner out there, and he is hammering him. Humongous seems almost like he's programmed. I mean, there's some control that Humperdinck has over him. That thing with where he sticks the two fingers in the eyes there and stops Humongous, it's an eerie control. I don't know if it's some kind of post-hypnotic suggestion or just what it is, but he's an awesome man. It's a lot of mystery surrounding the Barbarian situation. He disappeared. I don't know. Jake the Snake seems very non-committal about it. One face lock by the Nightmare. A powerful man. 290 pounds. Solid man. Strong. A former North American champion, you've got to remember. Tony Falk enters the ring. Tag is made. Tony Falk enters the ring. Now, what is Humperdinck doing to Humongous? He's done something. He touched him up there in that eye area. Seemingly has programmed him into some situation. The Nightmare just ran Tony Falk's face right into that mask, that hockey mask that covers the face of Humongous.
And again.
He just ran it in again. Tony Falk is badly lacerated. His face badly lacerated. Humongous tags in. Look how strong this man is. Mm. If that's the warning that Humperdinck has just given to Jake the Snake and Hacksaw Duggan and anybody else that steps in the ring, Shinnon Amaki, the powerful man, walks in, wastes no time, and Tony Falk has just been annihilated, and he has felt the power of Humongous and, of course, the intensity of the Nightmare. Humperdinck, the referee's calling for it. Humperdinck has not stopped the man yet. Now, look at that. Watch that. Humperdinck somehow controls this man.
Going back to where you pointed out, and we'll be back. Nick Patrick versus Ted DiBiase after this word.
This match on Mid-South Wrestling, one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first in the red corner, at 258 pounds from Omaha, Nebraska, Ted DiBiase. His opponent in the blue corner, at 228 pounds from Atlanta, Georgia, Nick Patrick.
Ted DiBiase being introduced to the crowd here, and you heard the boos. He takes on Nick Patrick on the outside of the ring. Dr. Death Steve Williams as Carl Fergie calls for the bell and the match underway.
You know, DiBiase came back a couple of weeks ago, and he was highly upset because he'd left Sweet Tan in control of his power of attorney on the Mid-South Tag Team Championships. And of course, Sweet Tan and Dr. Death had lost those titles. It was definitely an upset to Al Perez and Wendell Coolidge. DiBiase came back, and in his style, 2 weeks ago, he fired Bruiser Bob Sweet Tan. And then he tried to beat him up, and he lost a very expensive custom-made jacket as Sweet Tan ripped it from limb and ripped the clothes right off of him. And Dr. Death and Ted DiBiase have been very, very upset about that situation. Nick Patrick, first time here on Mid-South Wrestling. We understand he's a competent athlete, but we haven't seen him in the kind of competition you face when you come to Mid-South. And DiBiase, as he looks to his fan of Dr. Death out there to gain the plaudits from Dr. Death, is pretty cocky out there as he's really powering it in with those forearm smashes to the solar plexus area of Nick Patrick. Coming up, we have Hacksaw Duggan and Jake the Snake next against El Casario and Dirty Dutch Mantel. Remember, next week, Hacksaw Butch Reed defends his TV title. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert will be here. they're trying to negotiate a tag title defense by Perez and Cooley against DiBiase and Dr. Death.
Nick Patrick just caught DiBiase with a body slam. He caught him with a series of body slams. This youngster says, hey, your reputation isn't going to win this match. The ring wise, DiBiase pops him a good one. DiBiase shows him that turnbuckle that brings you to a sudden stop like a freeway wreck. And he threw Nick Patrick out on the floor. Dr. Death standing there. He's promised not to interfere, but we've seen that before, Boyd.
We certainly have, and we're watching now.
So is the official. Carl Fergie's keeping his eye on him, but Doc just steps back. Carl Fergie telling Ted DiBiase to let him in the ring. DiBiase made sure he got in while he's still a little bit addled from that fall on the floor there. And DiBiase really pouring it on. That's the mark of a great competitor. That's the mark of the men that are champions. That when they get somebody in a lot of trouble, they don't let up. They bear down. DiBiase certainly ring-wise an international star. He is really punishing young Nick Patrick. That steel cable inside those rubber hoses has no give. It shut down the air.
Come on, Teddy!
Oh, DiBiase with the flat of the foot. That's legal. Doc cheering him on. Dr. Death Steve Williams, a powerhouse in his own right. He and DiBiase is certainly one of the most formidable tag teams in the world today. DiBiase, that suplex. Carl Fergie goes to the cap. DiBiase pulled him up. He wants to punish Nick Patrick. That, I think, I don't care how good you are, becomes a mistake. That's an ego situation that can cause you trouble when you got a guy beating. See, look at that. DiBiase in a little bit of trouble right there as Nick Patrick got a second chance. But DiBiase quickly kicks it in gear. I think he realized he's fooling around. Now he's going for that figure four leg lock that he's the master of. And you can hear Nick Patrick, he's hollering. He's in a lot of agony. Ted DiBiase got it. Nick Patrick made it to the rope. He made it to the rope. Carl Fergie calling for the break. DiBiase's got to break the hold.
Bill, he should have taken that victory just a few seconds ago.
Yeah, sure should have. DiBiase pulling him back in the ring. DiBiase, Dr. Death just got covered. Bob Sweet Tan versus Sweet Tan. He just came out of the clear blue and attacked Dr. Death. I don't think DiBiase's even aware of it. Bruiser Bob Sweet Tan, he just smacked Ted DiBiase. Sweet Tan is down there to pound and duck. DiBiase is going to his tights. He's loading that glove. Sweet Tan, he didn't come to help Nick Patrick. He just comes to kick some tail. But Nick Patrick just helped Sweet Tan. It's street style. Carl Fergie calling for the disqualification, certainly. But Dr. Death and Ted DiBiase, they aren't hearing any bells, but the one Sweet Tan's making off in their heads is the Bruiser, former Brass Knucks champion. I can attest to the fact he's a tough, formidable opponent.
He's with a low center of gravity.
And Dr. Death and DiBiase left. He'll go in the record books as a win for DiBiase. But Sweet Tan didn't come to help Nick Patrick, but it's still a disqualification. But Bruiser Sweet Tan is taken again and humiliated Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death.
In the wild tag team match, Duggan and Jake the Snake versus Mantell and Corsario after this word from Mid-South Wrestling.
This tag team event on Mid-South Wrestling, one fall or television time remaining. Introducing first the team in the red corner at 236 pounds from Puerto Rico, El Casario. And at 232 pounds from Oil Trough, Texas, Dirty Dutch Mantell. Their opponents at 275 pounds from Glens Falls, New York, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. And his partner, the man with a DDT at 251 pounds from Atlanta, Jake the Snake Roberts.
And just to the fans, in anticipation of what a battle and confrontation it will be, Dirty Dutch Mantel and El Casario versus New York's Hacksaw Jim Duggan and Jake the Snake, as Tommy Gilbert calls for the bell. It's Jake the Snake against Dutch Mantel, and it's on.
I guarantee you, boy, if I was Dutch Mantel, I think I'd have left my bullwhip in that dressing room. You know, my daddy said don't take something in a fight that's not chocolate. You might have to eat it. And look at that pair across the ring. Jake the Snake with the most vicious hold in wrestling. Many guys are trying to imitate his hold, but nobody has it like he does with the quickness, the power, and the leverage, the DDT. And Hacksaw Duggan, a man that knows no fear, but's liable to take anything you got away from you and beat you to death with it. I mean, this is a great television main event. And we got more next week. Hacksaw Butch Reed is going to defend his TV title right here. Wendell Cooley and Al Perez were trying to negotiate that tag team title match here on television. Ted DiBiase naturally trying to get everything set his way. And of course, hot stuff, Eddie Gilbert, the man who made the most audacious offer on television for all the young ladies that wanted his picture, could write in 25 words or less just why they deserve to get it. He'll be here next week. That's this crowd. They were chanting Duggan, Duggan, Duggan when they came out, and then the DDT, DDT. And, of course, El Casario is like a ship without a rudder with Skandar Akbar gone, but he's a martial arts expert. We know he's deadly. But Jim Duggan, 285 pounds, you saw earlier. Even the world's champion Ric Flair has a new respect for Duggan, and so does everybody that saw that match in its entirety. He's always been known as a great brawler. What a lot of people didn't know is what a great wrestler he is. He's always been known for that great heart. And of course, Jake the Snake going for that mask, and he unmasked the Nightmare here a few weeks ago on TV. And now, of course, the Barbarian mysteriously disappeared, and Humperdinck leveling charges and crying foul. How can any man like Humperdinck cry foul? Jake the Snake caught it in the back. And again, that El Casario, a martial arts expert, dangerous and deadly. Tags in Dirty Dutch Mantel. Dutch, a former TV champion, until Butch Reed took his measure, a man from Waldrop, Texas, who asks no quarter and gives none. And Dutch is trying to get Duggan's goat, because everybody knows that Duggan's got a pretty quick temper. Buzz Sawyer today almost had a brawl going during a commercial break. Not easy. It seems like the dragon, when you give him a challenge, it's like a bull seeing red. Listen, look at that. El Casario just caught Jake the Snake with that thrust kick. Listen to this crowd. Solidly behind Duggan and the Snake. This is a great main event. These guys are a well-matched team.
And Bill, to back up what you said earlier, I see a lot of wrestling, and a lot of wrestlers are, like you say, they're trying to imitate the DDT, They cannot duplicate it.
I've seen some of the guys with all the national TV exposure even try it, but you haven't seen anybody be able to do it. Not like Jake the Snake. We're winding down here. This match could go the distance. 2 minutes of airtime left. El Casario pounding away against Jake the Snake. Knee lift. At 6'5", Jake the Snake has that tremendous leverage. Tag is made. The big man, Duggan, but they drove Jake to the floor. Duggan's by himself. He's going to have to walk tall by himself. And Duggan is carrying the battle. I don't think he realizes Jake has been not. Dutch Mantel's getting that bull whip. He just whipped Duggan. Oh, Duggan caught it.
He got it.
Duggan's caught it. Look at him. Duggan's caught it. Oh, Jake the Snake's back in there. Wow, DDT, DDT, and El Casario. El Casario just got the other end of that whip. I think the more effective end, he got the butt end of it. And Jake the Snake and Hacksaw Duggan just won this match against Dutch Mantel and El Casario, boy.
They certainly did.
What a great bout. We've had some great matches here. Thanks to Joel for that new video on Wendell Cooley. Also, the video on Dark Journey. Next week, boys, some great bouts.
They are. Hopefully, we'll be able to see Al Perez and Wendell Cooley defend their Mid-South titles against Ted DiBiase and Dr. Death Steve Williams. but Butch Reed will be here and will defend his Mid-South Television Championship.
The fantastic Bobby
Fulton, Tommy Rogers from the City of Angel. They'll be here in Hot Stuff, Eddie Gilbert. I hope you'll join us. You saw and liked it this week. There's going to be more of the same. And so far, the greatest commentator I know of, and that's all I can say, and that's good enough. Cowboy Bill Watson, for our other crew that'll join you next week, Jim Ross and Joel Watts, I'm Boyd Pearson. Thank you so much for watching. We'll see you next week on the Mid-South Wrestling Television Network.